So what the World Environment Day is and what will be there on the 5th of June 2021 and with which aim we will be going with. So the first thing which I would like to discuss is it's the World Environment Day on 5th June and we are celebrating it in an advance, I must say. And the theme of this World Environment Day is ecosystem restoration, and which itself says preventing, halting, and reversing the degradation of the ecosystems worldwide. It itself says that we are from 1972, which I can say that it is the birth of this World Environment Day, the UN Conference on the Human Environment, that is the also known as the Stockholm Conference, and coming with the aim from only one Earth in 1974, and in the last decade, from many species to one planet, and from green economy to raise your voice, not the sea level, connecting people with the nature, beating the air pollution, and time for nature, and now slowly, slowly entered into reversing, into preventing, into halting, and reversing the degradation of the ecosystems worldwide. And to reimagine, to recreate, and restore. Repeating the same thing. This is our movement. But what we can do is that we can grow trees, we can green our cities, we can rebuild our gardens, we can change our diets, clean up the rivers and coasts. Coming to 2020 and 2021, if I must say, then I must say standing with the second wave of coronavirus and intermittent lockdowns with more than 2 crores reported cases and more than 3 lakh casualties in our country, and with the whole of the country under the epidemic threat and with glued with the fear of the third lockdown in the near future. This is our present. But the emergence of COVID-19 has reminded us how the consequences of ecosystem loss and degradation can be. Degradation of these fragile ecosystems, their habitats, which have created ideal conditions, I must say, for these once harbored pathogens such as coronavirus, bird flu, Ebola, SARS, Zika virus to come in direct contact with the human beings and to spread. And nearly 75% of all these emerging infectious diseases are of zoonotic origins. See what we have done. We must realize, we must ponder of, we must think of these things. When we are saying of restoration, of ecological restoration, we must ponder of these things, and we must be very serious. I must say, we are gripped in a sense of fear, feeling totally locked down, choked sometimes, and in a fear of uncertainty with the Olympics, with the IPLs, meetings, conferences, and every day we are seeing marriages being either postponed or cancelled. But I am reminding you that the same situation was that of the environment, and in particular of Delhi, I must say, and other metropolitan cities, if I say nearly 1 year back, it was totally choked in a fear, grappling with the loads of pollutants and searching for an opportunity to revive the next day, and asking the creator, that is from us, the humans, that the humans, they will take care of, looking towards the engineers of the ecosystem, we, the engineers of the ecosystem, to feel pity, mercy on it, and as the measurable, taking in of view of the miserable count of air quality index, which had crossed the levels. Schools were about to shut, I must remind you. Work from home was about to be advised of the citizens, taking in view of the air pollution. And with the commencement of the year 2020, just after it, the virus had started engulfing more or less all the countries, and we too were gripped by the fever of coronavirus and are still grappling with the same since late March 2020. although we are passing through a very tough time, and you will be surprised to know that nearly three generations are becoming evidence to such a pandemic. We, our parents and the children, as the last one was the Spanish flu pandemic, which swept the globe in three deadly waves between 1918 and 1990. Although I must here add, this one was the worst to date, and we must remember. On the other hand, looking outside our balconies through the monsoon, through the coming monsoon in its full bloom, and the trees loaded with colors, the birds chirping as they were and had since centuries, but we had no time to see them. We have realized, although in these lockdowns, these things, you have gone through different magazines, different newspapers loaded with nature right now. Why? Most of us have, I must say, realized the beauty of nature for the first time, although and might have developed a sense of belongingness with them during this period of lockdown, which was overcome by hustle and bustle of the cities and our workloads. The development, which I must say, the drastic measures taken by the governments to curb the spread of this novel coronavirus and putting the lockdown of the heavy industries, in particular the last year I am discussing with you, so that we can have an experience of whole of the year, what happened with us and the nature. The factories, commercial establishments and vehicular movements has led to steep a drop in the pollution levels across the world. In the thick of all the gloom and doom, there is a silver lining. Mother Earth seems to have rejuvenated, reinvented itself, and have bounced back with her full resilience, and have paved the waves to the blue skies. The great and mighty Himalayas looking more closer to Jalandhar and Saharanpur after remaining invisible for more than three decades. Marine life is seeing increased activity. Endemic Ganges dolphins have started flocking. The Ganges flowing through the cities. Pollution levels have dropped, and animals as well as birds are moving as if good times have come. Every day we are getting news. For example, a few days back, an unexpected guest, a Nilgai, was spotted walking on the road, which was totally different from what the roads were designed for. It was designed for thousands and thousands vehicles to ply and to emit the gases, so that we may put wheels on the economy, and that too gearless, brakeless with the high accelerators. Some sightings were being sighted across Kerala, Kozhikode, where a critically endangered Indian civet was spotted walking on the road. Longhorned sambar tree in Chandigarh, spectacular sights with nearly 8 lakh olive red-lipped turtles coming out of the ocean in the wee hours of the night at Rishikulya coast in Odisha. Giant flock of birds swirling in the skies of Ahmedabad with a blend of peach, pink and blue colors. So I am just taking you with the nature. I'm trying to take you with the nature. You have to restore it. This is our aim. This is what we are sitting here with. So, and in addition to it, schools of dolphins were flocking in the Arabian waters near Mumbai's marine dry coast. These are all what we have experienced. And our children and we, the people, have not experienced these things ever. Means I must say, when living in the city, we have not got an experience of these things. And that is all due to reduction in noise pollution. That is all improvement in air. The quality in the air has improved. That is all because of that. That is all because of the movements, because of the decreased human movements coming to a standstill due to this national or state-wise lockdowns. It seems that when man is confined behind doors and is engaged, I must say, in sanitizers and napkins, the wild, in particular the urban wildlife, has found opportunities to reclaim their space once theirs hundreds of years back, as if they have returned to their natural habitats, which was encroached by us, that is, the mighty human beings. with the drastic slowdown in travel, both domestic, national and international, air traffic at a standstill, trains creased in a line, factories and kilns shut, the air quality has emerged more clearer. And a preliminary study with us during a thesis has revealed that in 5 districts of Madhya Pradesh, including the most polluted industrial city with the gargling thermal reactors, Singrauli has also resulted in surprisingly well. And I must say this lockdown, although to prevent a very infectious disease, have paved way for us to stop and think for the nature, for the cruelties, I must say, which has been inflicted by us on this and made other species also to suffer because we act and other species, they suffer. Are we really law-abiding citizens? In this talk, I must say that, are we really law-abiding citizens every time we say, when we are doing injustice to those who can't raise their voices, but simply they resist, and that their mesmerizing voices being low slowly in the thunderous celebrations just to rush our adrenaline? Are we really law-abiding citizens? The transformation and rejuvenation of Yamuna water can be identified by considering the fecal coliform, which has been reduced to nearly 300 amperes from 1300 during the lockdown, as per the recent studies conducted for the Yamuna River, which is flowing through the capital, India's capital. Badevel, a dream of millions residing in the city. The Ganges water has also improved, and in some cases it is suitable for drinking purpose. This is all due to reduction in the discharge of untreated industrial effluents. This is Mother Nature. Give it some time. Give our loving, our caring hands towards the nature will be loaded with unestimated. I'm not changing the slides. I'm just talking. I'm not changing the slides. I'm just talking. I will come back with the slides. Yeah, I saw your chat. I'm just talking with you people. That's why I was invited here. This is Mother Nature. Give it some time. But the ever increasing population, the industrialization, it has posed an immense pressure on these natural resources. The platter to feed, that is our breakfasts, our lunch, our dinners, and all, is part of the intricate ecosystem services. What is this? Our vegetables, our fruits, our bread, what is this? It's a product of the intricate ecosystem services, the medicines, the food, the aesthetic beauty, the nature, the natural beauty we say, and what it is all. I will discuss it with an example of us which we are working with. All it is the product of the intricate ecosystem services, the delicate ecosystem services. See what we have done, loaded our plate, bladder, the water bodies, aquatic flora and fauna with pesticides and insecticides, and made the once fertile natural land into barren land. Punjab and Haryana are an example to this. It's time to think, to reclaim, to restore the nature's web working for us tirelessly without asking for returns. What it is asking is to give some time to rejuvenate. I'm there for your service, and we teach our students, and now it is becoming a common notion, ecosystem services. But that service is asking just to give some time, that I need some time, sir, to please rejuvenate myself. Use the resources cautiously and live in harmony with the nature. It's high time, again I must repeat the same thing, to reimagine, to recreate and restore. My question is, why so much sophistication? Why so much complexity to solve a simple problem? Give the Mother Nature some time to rejuvenate and reinvent a simple example. I'm quoting. For example, when temperature rises, we start using air conditioners and all these appliances. What will they do is that they will start drawing energy from the fossil fuels, the carbon stored. And the solution we find in carbon mitigation then. See, what has we piled up? We have piled up with metals, with plastics across the urban ecosystem, raised the heaps of dumping grounds, and the AC invariably heated the air. The gas leakage from the air conditioners released dangerous gases. And what we have done is that we have started penetrating and thinning the ozone layer and invited the UV rays to come up. And now we are using UV glasses to avoid them. And we must think that we are just guests on this planet Earth. We are just guests. And these guests are now, I must say, guests to various super specialty hospitals. Think we only thought of relieving ourselves from the temperature, and we have landed, and where we have landed in these 3 or 4 decades. By these things, sometimes when we talk, then they say that you are against the development. No, I'm not against the development. I'm not against modernity of cities. I'm not against urban landscapes being loaded with the infrastructure. But on the same time, I'm in favor of sustainable development, of using the resources in a more balanced way. And when it is required the most, we have to think towards conserving the energy, especially the energy driven from the fossil fuels or non-renewable sources of energy, the major propellers of greenhouse gases, climate change, blah, blah, and must think of alternative sources of energy, which we say cleaner energy and never-ending energy, the solar energy, the tidal energy in form of green buildings and making them a green planet, making it a green planet. The air purifiers, I'm not going in the detail, are again a dim story which needs to be shared with. Nowadays, we are using air purifiers also when I go to Delhi again. So I must say development and nature should go hand in hand and not face to face. They should not confront each other. Development and nature should not confront each other. They should go hand in hand. As a teacher, as a student, and a scholar working on rural livelihood in tribal areas, I will share some slides with you people, and always working and propagating and advocating the culture, the way of living, of being connected to the nature and caring it as a mother, I would say the time has come to follow and inculcate the lifestyles of our tribal brothers and sisters in part, if I will say, or and last year, after this lockdown, say in June, July, we were on a field visit in the interiors of district Anuppur, in which our unit, and we came across a village. We were just chatting with a seemingly economical poor family in terms of money, I should say only. I asked the head, how much land you are having? And in sign, he pointed his fingers and said, all this is mine. And nearly 50 hectares, I said. He said, yes. I said, why you are not doing agriculture in all this? And I asked him that this is all covered with trees, but you do not do agriculture. You are not doing agriculture. You're doing agriculture only on a very small patch. And the answer with a smile was, it is more than sufficient to feed our family of 5. This small patch out of this much land is more than sufficient to feed our family of 5. What a level of satisfaction, no greed. they will also live, and the nature too will thrive. But what about us, the proud urban dwellers, the most affected by the coronavirus and most of the diseases most of the times, and I must say most commonly the hypertension and diabetes have started becoming a part of us. We have to ponder of this satisfaction. We don't have to conquer this nature, but we have to live in harmony with the nature. At last, we are just a part of it. We are not nature, we are just a part of it. The present situation, although have impacted my tribal brothers and sisters, see what we are doing in the cities and who is suffering, the forest dwellers a lot. But again, as the spring comes and comes up with the spring, in the spring will come in their meager economies, they will be able to churn out their annual income from selling the non timber forest products such as tendu leaves, paan leaves, mahua, lac, honey, wild fruits, medicines, rooted vegetables, etc. In these months, selling to nearby railway stations in particular, which are lying vacant and that have emptied their pockets. A gloom of insecurity, although lights. See how badly we are affected, and each and everyone is affected when this nature it gets hurts. But the sustainable way of living in harmony and seasonal ups and downs will not have much impact, unlike the urban dwellers. And once a lady quoted to me that we will find a way, as we have through centuries, like the nature does, a common notion. But what will be the future ahead? Again, we have to think of. Here I must add that we must never make these sightings of dolphins in the urban water bodies, civets on the roads, nilgai and deers venturing with us once for all, and have to share out the democratic rights, I must say, with the mute but active citizens driving the parliament of nature and making way for us to thrive on this planet Earth. Here I must again say that these sightings and improvements should not be at the cost of economic slum down or sluggishness in the job opportunities, creating a flurry of unemployment, poverty, malnourishment, or hunger around us. The answer is no, but yes, it can be achieved through sustainable development by living in harmony with all the species, coexistence, symbiosis, creating space for them to grow, and as having immense brains to think, as we are having immense brains to think, to groom the fellow species, to give them their spaces, their share on this planet, instead of using our mighty brawns to push them either in shrinked habitats which we have created, or confined to ever shrinking, highly impacted reserved areas, which we say, such as national parks, sanctuaries, and biodiversity parks. These learnings during our lockdown period should be transformed into greater transformations in the ways that we thought separately of nature. This lockdown period should be like an eye opener, and we must dream of a future with the world relying less on carbon, reduction in carbon footprint and ecological footprint in total, a sustainable way of living ahead. There must be some structural changes also. Some legislative reforms also are needed, and they needs to be implemented in the most strictest possible way, as the lockdown we have experienced. And we must learn community participation for the conservation of nature. Forests, as exemplified by us during this coronavirus, as we have fought unitedly during this fight against coronavirus, only then we can change and let the nature to bounce back. and by doing this we will be able to balance the panch tattva, that is the akash, agni, jal, prithvi and vayu. So now again I am coming back to the community participation, that we have to sit together and we have to share our experiences. What can be the challenges? What are the solutions? And this is the basis of what we are, why we are sitting today and pondering of. These are the three things. What are our experiences? What has happened with us? What are the challenges? How we can solve it? All of us have to decide and we have to grow together. And
Dr. Sandeep,
that is our community. Yes, sir. Just 5 minutes, sir. So the complexity of the ecosystem, which I was just sharing with, is in terms of the flora and fauna. And just giving you an example of the system on which I am working, that is the lac insect. Because see how diverse the lac insect is. There are morphological differences. See, a teeny insect, that is, it's very hard to see through our naked eye, is more than 400 plant species, feeds on more than 400 plant species, is harboring a fungi, that is yeast-like symbionts. Through molecular studies, we have done this work. Through, is harboring a bacteria, is harboring a virus, that is a bacteriophage, a very teeny insect, small insect. And more than 22 species of predators are associated with this insect. More than 75 species of primary and secondary parasites, numerous fungi. And this whole culmination results into the product that is lac. And then only we are able to wear the bangles of lac. See the complex, see the intricacies behind a small product lac. See how much work they are doing. This is ecosystem. This is the web. So we have to stop this. We have to stop this degradation. Otherwise, we should be ready. We must be ready with the cyclones coming off, with the natural calamities coming on. Who will provide the solution? Small steps will provide the solution, but with big aims. And it is us, the youth. Sustainable agriculture, I'm just skipping. And we have inculcated these things. We are trying these things to work upon in our tribal dominated areas. For example, lac cultivation, honeybee keeping, and we are involving the people in this. And now what is the role of higher educational institutes? How we can contribute? So just moving through, this is how the students, they have worked in the nearby villages and they have transformed the lives of people. Anemia is a problem in the nearby villages. So during every occasion, the group of students, they go to the villages and they encourage the people living there, the villagers living there, to plant a tree, and that to a fruit yielding tree. Just they, what they have to do is that they have to create they have to dig a space for us, and they have to throw biodegradable materials which is coming out from their household every day. And when once it is ready, they have to inform us and we will go and we will plant a fruit yielding tree in there. So the students, they have played an important role. See how with the waste teams, they are able to conserve the water. See this, I hope you are able to see, they are conserving the water, the rain water, so that it's reusable. We have revived more than 100, I must say, biogas plants in nearby villages, compost pits. This is us, which we can do. We can transform much of these toilets, which was being funded by the government, were of no use. Awareness, it speaks a lot. And now these are functional toilets. This is a model toilet using the waste which a farmer is having, the villagers are having. We are preparing model toilets for them. That don't, if you are not investing much money, come up with us, give some material to us, and we'll try to build. The students are doing. And see, this is how every step counts. So we are just segregating the material, and now these little chaps, they have become our volunteers in the villages. Plantation drives, and we will keep on moving. Thank you. Sorry, I was not knowing that I was not able to elaborate much of these stories with you, taking in view the scarcity of time. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sandeep Kaushik. You have given wonderful eye-opening presentation where we need to work out. The urban communities are enjoying like anything, and the rural people are suppressed like anything. Though there are semi-urban communities which really do better, but the discussion what you have brought to the limelight, it is very wonderful. So one fine day again we'll be having one more talk by you in our university department meeting. So I wholeheartedly congratulate you for presenting such a wonderful eye-opening presentation and talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. Thanks to all the organizers again for inviting me. Thank you.